Yeah, that's me. Well, that's my avatar. At least, until I feel like changing.
Virtual worlds, augmented realities, and avatars are the topics of science fiction stories. However, some novels and comics that feature these elements may not be so far away from reality. The metaverse, a term coined by Neal Stephenson in his 1992 novel Snow Crash, is an online world with its own rules and nations. While it may sound like another futuristic concept reserved for cult classics like Ready Player One or Snow Crash, the metaverse is coming, and it will change human interaction as we know it. The metaverse is a virtual universe that includes virtual worlds, augmented reality, and the internet. It's a virtual world you can access through a computer or other device. It's a place where people interact and visit other worlds, and it's set to change the way people interact forever. More simply, you can think of it as a new way to experience life.
Metaverse, I at least think about it as the next chapter, the next evolution of the internet, except it's the part where it gets less flat. If you think about the primary metaphors for the internet to date have been about web pages and literally two-dimensional objects that we peer at through screens. One of the most important trends in computing has been the computer moves from a basement to our desktop to our pocket. That has happened over the last 50 years. And we believe, I think we as an industry believe, that it ultimately gets closer to the senses, to the eyes, to the hands, to speech. And so keyboard input goes away, and peering at everything through a screen in our pockets eventually goes away. The metaverse is a way of describing the transition into three-dimensional environments. Much like the internet, in the metaverse, you're gonna have service companies operating different systems with different rules. Some are gonna be way more open-ended. Some are gonna be rated R. You know, some are gonna be PG, and some of them are gonna have sort of more or less strictures around safety and integrity. There will probably be something like a rating system, which we have for film, we have for music, we have for other types of content, so that a parent or a young person can have some sense of what the rules are in their environment they're gonna walk into. Just like if you walk into a bar versus a playground, there's a different expectation of what rules govern that place. Some of them are social norms. Some of them are enforced by people who run those institutions.
If you want to participate in the metaverse as an active member of its community, it's important to know how these structured interactions work, so you can prepare yourself accordingly before jumping into any new games or experiences. Virtual reality, augmented reality, and the metaverse. The difference between AR and VR is that VR requires you to wear a headset to immerse yourself in an artificial world, while AR uses your phone or tablet to augment the real world you're already in. If someone watched you, they would see nothing out of the ordinary, other than you perhaps looking at your phone or tablet more than usual. VR is a more immersive experience. People use these technologies in many ways every day. For example, a high school student might use their phone during study hall to play games against other students across town. A doctor might use their computer monitor instead of paper charge during surgery. An architect could project blueprints onto walls using an overhead projector instead of putting them on display on boards near their desk. An athlete might watch video footage from past games on their smartphone while practicing new plays at home after school hours. The metaverse will be an entire universe built around these technologies.
Essentially, the metaverse is a blending of your physical and your digital world. Basically, it's a little frustrating as an augmented reality company that oftentimes the current dialogue around the metaverse is centered in virtual reality. So virtual reality is where you might put on a headset and you enter another world. And there's great opportunity for virtual reality. There's entertainment, there's training, there's things like that. But there's also augmented reality, where you still see your physical world and you augment it with digital content in front of your eyes. And both are the metaverse, which is why it becomes a little bit confusing. If you think about the digital infrastructure of the internet, that's the area that houses all of your data and the services and the applications that you use. And you enter the digital internet through a physical device, whether it's your mobile phone or the PC. The metaverse now will actually expand upon that, and it will be a merging of your digital and your physical worlds. Now, it's also important to note that the metaverse is not a singular destination. I think sometimes we come to see that from the media, that it's only one place. That would be like saying the internet is only one web page. But what it's going to be is an interconnected web of networks, much like the digital interface or the digital internet is, but it'll be expanded and it'll create new experiences for all of us. The metaverse is going to be the technological foundation of which we will build the future. It's where I think we'll actually see what's known as Web 3.0 really come to life. And when you buy digital assets, you'll be able to take them in and out of the metaverse, actually. Right now, we are early days in the metaverse, but I think much like the mobile phone industry, much of where the metaverse begins will likely be in business. And we see this already today in businesses that are used to wearing head-worn devices. So doctors who go into surgery might wear magnifiers or lights, and first responders or soldiers might wear helmets. And then in manufacturing, you might have safety glasses. Those seem to be the industries that are adopting this idea of digitally overlaying your physical world initially, and they're the ones who are actually seeing value today. On that, another example, there's an interesting company that is doing heart catheterization, and the surgeons used to insert the catheter by looking at a PC in front of them, and it's hard to visualize, or cognitively it's hard to visualize something on a flat screen. But this company has taken the heart, the live heart from the patient, real time, and mapped it and put it in front of the surgeon. And so now they're putting the catheter into the heart with much higher accuracy and navigation and less fault and better outcomes. So I think we will look back and say, wow, how could we ever have gone into the operating room without it?
Human interaction in the digital space has come a long way, and the future holds more exciting possibilities for human connection. The internet has always been a place where people can connect, but we're now entering a new era of digital interaction. The metaverse will make human communication more advanced than ever before. For example, if you're interested in going on an adventure but can't afford to leave town for several days or weeks at a time, you could use the metaverse as an alternative option. You could also meet new people from different parts of the world who share similar interests as yourself. Even if your online interactions are mostly limited to performing tasks at work or posting photos on social media, there will be new opportunities for you to engage with others, digitally, in ways that are exciting and meaningful for you.
If you think about the hyperlink just as a really brutalist, simple metaphor for the structure of portability that made the original internet work, was that I could click on a blue word and you will go from one service to another service. That was the structure that enabled Google, that enabled sort of the first generation of web services to build utility, was we had some agreement on what the primitives were of the internet. The primitives in the metaverse are going to be more complicated because travel, the equivalent of a hyperlink in the metaverse, is I can go from Second Life into a work meeting, and then I can go from there into an educational experience where I'm visiting the Colosseum, and then I can turn it all off, maybe, and be in an AR experience where I can just pull my messages up, or I can translate the person who's speaking a different language next to me. These are the kinds of things that I think we're all envisioning. You want them all to be interconnected, because from a user experience, that's just going to be a better experience. The first thing you want to do when you're in a Beat Saber, which is one of our most popular applications, if you're playing with your friend, is leave and go somewhere else. Not leave because it's a bad experience, but leave because you get bored and you want to do something after it. The industry as a coalition is spending a lot of time starting to talk about standards. What are the standards for an avatar? What are the standards for travel between one space and the next? What are the standards around privacy, around encryption, around how things like report buttons will work? The report button is the key element to help somebody in an unsafe situation flag something about it. And how we manage those experiences as an industry are going to be some of the most important questions on how we build something that's safe, but also that provides lots of opportunity for developers.
It will take time for these technologies to mature and become accessible enough for everyone who wants them. It may seem like science fiction now, but someday people might use avatars instead of their physical bodies as intermediaries between themselves and the world around them. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.